Methodist Church. We invite you to visit us on Sunday or participate in one of our ministries throughout the week. We provide an inviting atmosphere filled with smiles as soon as you enter the parking lot. A relaxing atmosphere to worship and grow in the Word of God. Join Reverend Marilyn White as she shares the gospel with our growing congregation. Welcome to one of the oldest United Methodist churches in Houston, Texas. Nestled just southeast of the fourth largest city in the United States, a big city church with a small town feel. Our youth activities are plentiful, and there is something for everyone at our church. Whether you live in the community or attend one of the major universities, you are welcome here. We thank you for visiting our website, but would love to see you in person. The service times are located on the homepage of our website. Trinity East United Methodist Church, in the heart of Houston. Please join us for a rewarding experience.
Good morning and welcome to Trinity East United Methodist Church, where Jesus Christ is Lord. We are so glad that you joined us for worship today, and I pray that you will be blessed through our songs of praise, prayers, and the preached word. As David proclaims in that Psalms 122, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We invite you today to come on in and bless the Lord with us, and let us exalt his name together. Amen.
Not in blame that happens when we proclaim your name.
All right. It's just good to praise the Lord. Church, it's now time to honor God with our giving, and we're going to pause here for a few moments to give you the opportunity to give and surrender in your giving to God. The Bible says, let each one give as a purpose in their heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. I want to say thank you for your support of this ministry thus far, as we seek to do the will of God. There are numerous ways to give here at Trinity East: cash, app, Giveify, PayPal, Zelle, through our website, or just through plain old snail mail. Go to our website at www.trinityeastumchouston.org, and it will give you all the ways that you can give here. Thank you so much for supporting this ministry with your giving. We also want to just encourage you again to join us online or by phone for the many ministry opportunities we have here at Trinity East. On Monday nights at 8 p.m., we have our prayer line open for prayer. On Thursdays at 6 p.m., we have Bible study. And on Sunday mornings, we have three different Sunday school classes that are going on. You'll find the information how to log on by Zoom or by your telephone on our website again at www.trinityeastumc.org. Also, I want to invite you to join us next weekend as we'll be celebrating Men and Women's Annual Day. That's August the 29th at 3 p.m. by Zoom as well. And you can log on Zoom, or you could use your telephone and call in and be a part of that dynamic celebration. We have two guest speakers coming in to be with us on that Saturday. We have Reverend Goldsmith from Journey of Faith United Methodist Church, and we have Dr. Lakeisha Barnett from Willa Avenue Baptist Church, as well as Latoya Randolph, our guest soloist, and Gregory Daniels, saxophone man, coming to bless us through music. So join us on next Saturday, August 29th at 3 p.m. We'd love to see you. Thank you. Now let's go to worship as our awesome praise dancers come forth with praising God through dance.
Brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you back to life, back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
and the church saying, come on.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank God for the opportunity to praise Him. The Bible says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise Him with the timbrel and dance. Praise Him with every instrument that God has given us. Praise Him with all our being, church. I don't know about you, but I'm just so glad to be able to lift up the name of Jesus. Would you join us today for a word of prayer? Oh, gracious and holy God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for new mercy and grace for this day as you woke us up to be a part of your day. We thank you, God, that you still have a plan and purpose for our life, a plan to bless us and not to curse us, to give us a future and a hope. We thank you for this opportunity to bring forth your word. You said your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Help us this day to walk in the light and be shining so brightly for you that others will come running, what must they do to be saved? And we'll be living testimonies of your surely goodness and mercy that follows us all the days of our life. Father, we lift up all your people today. We pray your healing touch upon the land. We thank you that you are the God who heals. If you can't do it, nobody can. But we thank you for physical, spiritual, and mental healing this day. We give you all the glory and honor. Father, as I bring forth your word, let me decrease so that you can increase and your word will come forth from you, because you said your word shall not return void, but will accomplish everything you set it out to do. Have your way, your will, in Jesus' name, amen. Church, today we will be coming out of the book of James. As you all know, I've been preaching every Sunday from the book of James because we do our Bible study on Thursday nights at 6 p.m. from the book of James. We're still in chapter 4 of James, but today we're going to be coming from James 4, verses 13 through 17. I will be reading out of the New King James Version. It says, come now, you who say, today or tomorrow, we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell, and make a profit. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. This is the word of God for the people of God today. Thanks be to God. Today, I would like to use for my sermon topic, if God say the same, if God say the same. How many of you are guilty of boasting about tomorrow? How many of you have plans for today or tomorrow or this week or next month or even in 2021? You know, surely at times we are all guilty of boasting about tomorrow. We make plans of all kinds. We're gonna go here, we're gonna go there, we're gonna do this, or we're gonna do that, we're gonna buy this, or buy that, cook this, or cook that, eat this, eat that, and on and on and on. And yet not one of us have a clue what the next second is going to bring. Suddenly, like a puff of smoke, all those careful thought out and well-laid plans can go down in flames, church. See, our heads are full of visions as to what we shall do, what we shall be, what we shall enjoy. But the purpose of God is never in the equation. It does not seem to matter that we do not have a monopoly on our own life or certainty of the time allotted to us. But yet we promise ourselves tomorrow, not even considering what tomorrow will bring. The focus for our text is that we are to live life with God as the supreme ruler of our life, and let everything that we do be done as if we needed the Father's permission. See, James is a book full of practical wisdom and simple how-tos that wonderfully instruct us how to live out our life in faith. These verses that we're looking at today, church, describe people who are presumptuous and make assumptions about what they will do without even considering God. Although these people profess to know Christ, they were living with the worldly attitude that the Apostle John called the boastful pride of life. They were making plans without taking into account their own mortality and God's sovereignty. In all their planning, they left out the most important, the who. God was nowhere in their plans. They were self-absorbed, self-assured, self-confident, self-sufficient, self-indulgent, and self-centered. Ah, doesn't that sound like us sometimes, church? Notice they said, "We will go," as if nothing could slow them down. They were acting like the prosperous man in Jesus' parable in Luke 12, verses 19 through 20, who said, "I'll build bigger barns to store my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have laid up many goods for many years to come. Take your ease, eat and drink and be merry." But God said to him, "Church, you fool. This very night, your soul is required of you. And who will own what you've prepared?" In our text, James uses a metaphor of a vapor or a mist, and he makes several points. First point is that life is frail. Life is frail. James writes in that 13 to 14 verse, "Come now, you who say tomorrow, today, you will go to such and such city and spend a year there and engage in business and make a profit. Yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow." Other texts may read, "You do not know what will happen tomorrow." See, we don't even know what will happen 10 minutes from now, let alone tomorrow or next year. These businessmen were arrogantly assuming that they would wake up tomorrow, that they would safely get to the city, that their business venture would be successful within a year, and that no one would rob them of their income. They were presuming all of these things about an unknown future that they had no control of and no guarantees about. See, as I was preparing for this message, church, it was hitting my heart heavily, because this past January, my husband's birthday was January the 13th, and this year my daughter wanted to give him a big birthday party. I said, "No, let's wait until next year when he turns 70. And we decided to do that. But I remember what she said back to me. She said, "Next year is not promised, and none of us might be here next year." Well, church, 6 days later, my son was gone. Life is frail, and church, not only is life frail, but life is short. That's James' second point. Life is short. See, a vapor is short-lived. You see the mist at one moment, and a few minutes later, it's gone. You see the steam coming out of a cup of coffee, and just in a second, it disappears in the air. See, life is like that. I remember growing up, and my sister watched one soap opera every day. I was fascinated, y'all, by the opening of that soap opera, because it was an hourglass that was turned upside down and the sand was pouring down, and the announcer would come on with this strong voice and he would say, "Like the sand in an hourglass, so are the days of our lives." See, sand flows through an hourglass swiftly, and so do our lives. In Psalms 90, Moses laments the brevity of life. He compares life to the grass of the field that sprouts up in the morning and by evening is faded under the hot sun. He writes in verse 10, "As for the days of our lives, they contain 70 years or if due to strength 80 years. Yet their pride is but labor and sorrow, for soon it is gone, and we fly away. Even if you live to be 100, how quickly life flies by. I heard someone say that life is like the roll of toilet paper. The closer you get to the end, the quicker it goes. You may not care for that analogy, but guess what, church? It's true. That's why Moses prays in verse 12 of Psalm 90, "So teach us to number our days, that we may present you with a heart of wisdom. Teach us to live to the fullest, leaning and depending on God." Jesus said, "I came that you may have life and have it more abundantly." So teach us to number our days. Teach us to lean and depend on God. Look how James sets up this verse 15. He said, "Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that." And so my next point is that God is sovereign. That means we are not sovereign. The problem was not that these businessmen were making plans for the future, nor was it a problem that they were capitalists engaging in business to make a profit. See, planning is commended to us in the scriptures. In Luke 14, 28, Jesus says, "For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it?" See, financial planning is good stewardship if it's done in dependence on God with regard for biblical principles. It's wise to have a will, a living trust. It's wise to have some savings to cover possible future expenses or the potential loss of a job. The Bible commends hard work and being rewarded financially for it. The problem that Jane hits was they were planning as if they were sovereign and they were not bowing before our sovereign God. They were arrogantly making plans for their future financial security, but their plans did not include God. Their trust was not in God, but in their business ventures and in all the money they were supposed to make. They were assuming that they were in control of their future and that everything would go according to their plans. Instead, church, they needed to acknowledge, and we need to acknowledge, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. Church, James is not giving us a simple formula that we need to tack onto every sentence. Sometimes Paul used the phrase, "if the Lord wills," when speaking about the future, but sometimes, church, he did not. But he always depended on God, and he bowed before his sovereignty with regard to the future. So James is giving us a mindset that needs to permeate all of our life. We need continuously to be aware of our finiteness and depend on God and his sovereign purpose in every aspect of our lives. Sometimes we should say, "if the Lord wills." But even if we don't see it, guess what, church? We should think it. One of the most basic and helpful lessons in life is to learn this, that God is God and I'm not God. He's sovereign and I'm not sovereign. He controls the future and I do not in any way control the future. So James states that life is a vapor and that God is sovereign over every aspect of our lives. Then his word implies another truth, and that's this: that pride is a great sin that easily plagues all of us. I think I'm gonna say that again. Pride is a great sin that easily plagues all of us. Verse 13 reads, "With arrogance, today or tomorrow, we will go to such and such city and spend a year there and engage in business and make a profit." There's a lot of mention of what we will do, but there isn't any mention of God. In verse 16, James directly confronts the sinful attitude behind their comments. "But as it is," he says, "you boast in arrogance. All such boasting is evil." Church, Napoleon Bonaparte was a military genius, but his pride led to his downfall. He was about to invade Russia, but a friend tried to dissuade him. When it became apparent that Napoleon would not be budged, the friend shared the familiar proverbs with him. Man proposes and God disposes. Well, Napoleon angrily snapped back. He said, "I dispose as well as propose." See, as Christians upon a Christian upon hearing this remark made this comment, "I set that down as the turning point of Napoleon's fortunes." And sure enough, Napoleon's invasion of Russia was the beginning of his downfall. That was the beginning of his downfall because he was operating in arrogance, not giving God any of the credit, but taking credit for himself. This is what Napoleon does, and I don't need anybody else. How many of us fall victim to that same mentality? I brought myself up, and I don't need anybody else. Probably James' readers who were professing Christians were not as crash as Napoleon in proclaiming their own greatness. But it's easy for us as Christians to think, "I have succeeded because of my own hard work and smart business sense." And then we look down on the poor thinking, "Well, if they would only work as hard as I do, they could succeed too." But we're forgetting what Paul pointed to, the question he asked to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 4:7. He said, "What do you have that you did not receive? And you, if you did not receive it, why do you boast as if you have not received it?" See, everything we have comes from God by his grace. We fall into pride when we do not keep that in mind. So, church, how then should we live in view of the fact that life is a vapor, that God is sovereign, and that we are prone to pride? Well, James gives us an answer. Humble obedience to God's revealed will is the only course we should take. In the last verse of our text, James begins with, "Therefore." "Therefore" seems to connect it to what James has just said. So James ends saying, "In light of all that I've told you, therefore, to one who knows the right thing to do and does not do it, to him or her, it is sin." See, he's urged us to take the Lord in consideration in all our planning. We therefore have no excuse in this matter. We know what we are to do. To fail not to do it, James wants to make clear, is sin. James is talking about sins of omission. See, we all tend to focus on our sins where we violated some direct commandment of God. Perhaps we stole something in violation of God's command not to steal, or we lied in violation of God's command not to lie, or we get angry in violation of God's commandment against anger. But we also sin, church, when we fail to do something positive that God has commanded us to do. I'm talking about the sins of omission. He commands us to love our neighbor as ourselves. We violate that commandment when we hate our neighbor, of course, but we also violate it when we ignore our neighbor and live selfishly. See, if you are a Christian, it's not enough just to avoid sinning. God has given you a spiritual gift, and he calls you to serve him in some capacity. To know this and to neglect to do it is serving, is sin. See, ministry is first a mindset and only secondarily an activity. If you come to church just to sit and take in whatever seems to grab you or to meet with your friends, you do not have a ministry mindset. See, you are just sitting using the church to meet your needs with no regard of what God wants to you, how he wants to use you. You are a religious consumer, but you're not doing what God has called every believer to do. A ministry mindset means that every day you pray, "Lord, here I am. I'm ready to do your will. Give me eyes to see people as Jesus see them, like sheep without a shepherd. Give me a heart of compassion as Jesus has, to love those who are distressed or downcast. Use me today as a worker in your harvest for your sovereign purpose. See, James would impress upon us this critical piece of knowledge that God is the one who sustains our lives, that each day's 24 hours are not ours, that God controls time and he gives it to us as one of his good gifts, and that we would be blown away in God's judgment if it was not for his mercy. Somebody ought to thank God for his mercy. Life is short. Death is sure. Sin the cause. But guess what? Jesus is the cure. Church, life is too uncertain and too short to live it without God at the center. No amount of money, influence, power, or planning can guarantee tomorrow. Only God can grant us another sunrise or another breath. We ought to declare with David in Psalms 31:15, Lord, my times are in your hands. See, it's not wrong to make plans, but we must make sure they align with God's purposes. Proverbs 19:21 says, many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it's the purpose of the Lord that will stand. In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus included that sentence, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. See, praying for God's will and purpose to be fulfilled is fitting for all of our circumstances. In all circumstances, strive to be able to tell God, your will be done. In the upper room devotions, we get them at our church every month. And so I was reading the one for Friday, this past Friday, and there was a story in there about a man visiting a church member in the hospital. It may have been her pastor, I can't remember. But she had undergone many tests on her brain. Question that he asked her, he said, what would you like for me to pray for? He was expecting to hear requests such as healing, relief of pain, or to go home. He was surprised by the answer, though, church. She said, whatever is God's will and purpose for my being here, pray, Pastor, that it be fulfilled. Church, let us remember how wonderfully secure we are in the confidence that it's God who finally governs our lives. God and not chance. God and not our enemies. God and not disease. God and not the devil. I'm very glad that my life is in the hands of an all-loving, all-wise, all-powerful Father. I don't know about tomorrow, the songwriter said. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from the sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry over the future, for I know what Jesus said. And today I'll walk beside him, for he knows what lies ahead. Many things about tomorrow, church, I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Align with God's will, avoid arrogance, and act in total obedience. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Thank you. Future holds for each and every one of us. Nothing catches you by surprise or off guard. Isn't that good news, church? So today I want to make sure that we are grounded and rooted in Jesus. Somebody today, if you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, today is your day. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. The Bible says all you have to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, talking about Jesus. And it says, then you will be saved. You don't have to wait till somebody else pronounce it. God has already pronounced it. So check your heart today. Make sure your heart is clean and come with a repentant spirit. Lord, I want to be better. Lord, come in and help me to walk the way you would have me to walk. Not my will, but truly your will. If you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, we want to hear from you. Go on our website and drop me a note and say, Pastor, I have accepted Jesus today. Can you share with me how to walk out this life? Or maybe you've been out of touch, you've slipped away, and you want to come back. The Father stands with arms wide open to welcome us all back. So if that's you today, we also want to hear from you. Drop us a note on our website. Send us a prayer request. And we'll get in touch with you and we'll be praying for you in Jesus' name. May the Lord bless and keep you. May he watch over you and give you peace. May you be the light shining brightly that others will see Jesus high and lifted up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.